You're listening to Clearview Today with Dr. Abadan Shah, the daily show that engages mind and heart for the gospel of Jesus Christ. I'm Ryan Hill.
I'm John Galantis.
You can find us online at clearviewtodayshow.com, or if you have any questions for Dr. Shah or suggestions for new topics, send us a text to 252-582-5028, or you can email us at contact@clearviewtodayshow.com.
That's right, and you guys can help us keep the conversation moving forward by supporting the show. You can share it online with your friends and family. Leave us a good 5-star review on iTunes or Spotify, and where you get your podcasting content from. We're going to leave a couple of links in the description so you can do just that, Ryan.
Did you have a little cup tilt to the camera?
I gave a little cup tilt to the camera, but here's the thing.
Welcome to the conversation.
Here's the thing. I don't know if you could hear it in the audio. Maybe you can scrub back and listen. I took a too big of a sip, and then it was my turn to talk.
I'm John Galantis.
I had to swallow it down, and that's not good to do with scalding hot coffee.
Burning hot coffee.
Yeah, no, you don't want to do that right there.
Yeah, probably not.
Happy Taco Tuesday.
Happy Taco Tuesday
to everybody out there in Radio Land listening to the show. I had tacos last night. It was a Monday night taco dinner.
Tacos on a Monday.
And I had this, it was pretty good. Well, you got to lighten up the Monday somehow.
Sure.
Here's what I was thinking.
Okay.
And I thought about this, and I texted Libna, Dr. Shah's sister, to see, but I want to talk to Dr. Shah about it on the air. I thought this could be a good conversation. We're Americans, right? We were raised in the good old U.S. of A.
Correct.
And is there American food? Yeah, sure. You got hot dogs and hamburgers, but everyone will say, those are German. Those come from somewhere else. Whatever. We never say, I'm going to go eat American food when I go to a burger place.
True.
I'm just going to go get a burger. But I mean, some people might say, I'm going to eat tacos. But if they're going to a Mexican restaurant, they're going to say, I'm going to go get some Mexican food. I'm going to go get some Italian food.
That's true. And things that are distinctly American, like some Southern cooking, you would call it soul food.
Yeah, it's soul food. It's barbecue.
Right.
But it's not American food. No, right. I don't know any American who says, hey, I'm just going to go out and get some American food. So my question is this. If you're Mexican and you're living in Mexico and you go out to eat Mexican food,
are you eating Mexican?
Do you just eat food?
You go out for Mexican, or do you just go get food?
Or do you just say, hey, we're gonna go get some tacos, we're gonna go get some enchiladas, we're gonna go get, because I would say all that stuff is Mexican food,
right?
But would they say it?
That's a good point. This brings us to one of my very favorite dad jokes. You know dad jokes, like not the cringy, like but dad jokes where something is funny once and so you say it multiple times.
That's
until
my
it's
father.
Funny
yep,
no longer.
That's my father.
So this is one of my very favorites counting. To use on my kids. It never gets old for me, probably always gets old for them. I'd be like, I'd like a burger with some french fries. Or as they say in France, fries.
Okay, I like that one.
You got to do the eyebrows, as they say in France, fries.
I've always wondered that. Like, are they really French?
I don't think so.
Like, why are they French fries?
Maybe they are. I don't know. I don't know the origin of French fries.
I probably should do some research before getting on the radio and just talking. But do you know what I mean? Like, if you're an Italian and you're living in Italy and you go out and get you some pasta or spaghetti.
You wouldn't say, I'm going out for Italian food.
But what would you say? What would you say?
I guess, like, you just say the thing. Like, let's go get some pasta. Let's go get some fettuccine.
Yeah, but if you... some ravioli. Some lasagna with the mozzarella. But if you're going to a restaurant that serves Italian food in Italy and you're Italian, is it just the restaurant? I don't know. I don't know.
Yeah, I don't know what the protocol is there.
I asked Libda, and she said it just depends, which is the most unhelpful answer ever, by the way. If anybody... Like, that's one of the things that... This is a little mini
non-answer.
I don't like it depends. That's a weird answer. But I was like, so what do you call it? If you're in India and you're going out to eat Indian food with your friends, what do you say? And she was like, I mean, it just depends. And then I just was silent. And she was like, it just kind of depends. And I was like, okay, cool.
Conversation over.
Yeah, the question is not answered. So let's get Dr. Shah in here and let's ask him.
Write in and let us know if you have spent some time in another country and you are going out for that country's cuisine. What do you say? Are we going out for Italian in Italy, or are we just going out for food, for pasta?
Yeah.
What is that? What was that experience for you? 252-582-5028. Or you can visit us online at clearviewtodayshow.com. Stay tuned. We'll be right back.
Hello, Clearview family. I'm Nicole.
And I'm David.
And we want to talk to you today about the Clearview app.
You know, there are so many churches out there that put their sermons on YouTube and their announcements on Facebook and their prayer list on Periscope.
I didn't even know Periscope was still functional.
Oh, it's not. And that's why nobody can find their church's prayer list and nobody's prayers be getting answered. But here at Clearview, we believe in making our content as accessible as possible.
That's right. Clearview produces so much content every single week, including Dr. Shah's sermons, original music, a full online store, weekly prayer gatherings, and so much more.
Not to mention the number one best-selling Christian talk show of all time.
I don't know if that's accurate.
Well, maybe not yet, but that's why we want people to download the app.
If you're listening from the Triangle area, we encourage you to check out Clearview Church in person. But if not, you can still follow all of our content on the Clearview app. It's 100% free on the Apple Store and Google Play Store. And best of all of our content is right there in one convenient spot.
Make sure you download the Clearview app today, and let's get back to the show.
Welcome back to Clearview Today with Dr. Abadan Shah, the daily show that engages mind and heart for the gospel of Jesus Christ. You can visit us online at clearviewtodayshow.com, or if you have any questions or suggestions for new topics, send us a text at 252-582-5028.
That's right, and we're here once again in the Clearview Today studio with Dr. Abadan Shah, who's a PhD in New Testament textual criticism. Dr. Shah, here in the good old US of A, we've got lots of different culinary treats, shall we say?
Sure.
We got, there's no American food, but there is Mexican food. There's Italian food.
Yeah. Chinese.
There's Chinese food, of course.
Jalai.
There's, there's Japanese food. There's
Mediterranean.
Mediterranean Thai. Food, Thai food. Did I say Italian food? These all sound great.
Yes.
But I never say, hey guys, let's go get some American food. We always have to specify, like, let's get some Mexican. Let's get some Italian. When you're in India, if you're home, right, and you want some food. Well, first and foremost, do they have Mexican food? Do they have Italian food? That kind of stuff.
No, they do.
But growing up,
no.
So okay,
maybe in the big city like Bombay.
Uh-huh.
Which I didn't grow up in Bombay.
Right.
I grew up about seven eight hours by train.
Uh-huh.
To the east of Bombay.
Right.
Mm.
So going to Bombay, we didn't go eat Mexican food. I'm sure there were Mexican restaurants there.
Right.
I'm sure Chinese food was there.
Uh-huh.
But when we went to Bombay, we ate like, oh, we're going to go to that Iranian restaurant.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Okay.
Yeah, we're going to go to that Persian restaurant, which had like the best curry.
Right.
You can imagine. I mean, my mouth is watering right now.
does sound really good.
So one would assume, and correct me if I'm wrong here, but one would assume that they had what we would say, hey, we're going to go eat Indian food.
Right.
They sold that all over the place. Would you say, hey, we're going to go eat Indian food? Like
no.
Did you say we're just going to go eat food?
No, we would specify what we're going to go eat.
Okay.
So India is a kaleidoscope of food.
Okay.
Different peoples have come through India over the ages. I mean, over the past, I would say 3,000 some years, 4,000 years.
Mm-hmm.
And so, especially in the past 2,000 years, a lot of different cultures have come and passed through.
Right.
The Greeks have come, the Persians have come, the Mongolians have come.
Mm-hmm.
So a lot of these people have come, and they brought their own taste. And then India itself had this specialty for spices. I mean, the whole silk trade and all that. You know, spices coming on the silk trade.
Right.
Silk route. So a lot of the spices were in India. So the Persians came, right?
Right.
People don't think of the Persians as today's Iranians.
Right, right.
I mean, maybe some, but it was different.
Right.
So they brought things like biryani.
Okay.
Biryani is like a rice dish,
okay,
with meat, whether it's beef or chicken or goat, it's all that, but it has tremendous taste.
Really?
But coming to India, that same biryani with the spices took on a whole different level of food.
So is that Persian food? Is that what you would call it? Or has it become Indian food?
Biryani is just Indian now.
Okay,
yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. But originally, biryani itself, I mean, it sounds like the names of some of the Iranian leaders. Uh-huh. But I mean, it's Ayatollah Khomeini, biryani.
Biryani.
So,
of course.
They're coming from Persia.
Okay.
And then there are certain curries that came from that side of the world.
Mm-hmm.
And then tandoori chicken,
mm-hmm.
which is like they have this clay oven, mm-hmm. and it looks very red, but it's not hot. But it's like really, really good chicken.
Mm-hmm.
And that came from the northwest side of India,
mm-hmm.
and it was cooked in the ground, and it's all clean and everything,
right.
Not like somebody's street corner.
Right.
So it's a clay oven, so it has a special taste to it. And then South India has a whole different set of dishes.
So sometimes you're like, hey guys, let's go get some South Indian food.
Yes,
okay,
you would say that. Definitely say that.
Okay.
Sometimes you would say, hey, you want to get some tandoori chicken?
Okay.
Which is like North Indian food.
Right.
Then if you say, hey, you just want to get some, like Maharashtra, this is where I grew up, Bombay.
Mm-hmm.
It's not known for like South Indian food or tandoori chicken.
Mm-hmm.
It's like more, I know some Maharashtrians are like, what are you going to say?
Waiting with bated breath.
Maharashtrian food is more like the street food.
Oh.
Yeah.
Yeah?
Yeah, like a food truck.
Okay.
Oh, okay. Yeah, okay.
It's a street
food. Still good, though.
Still good, but it's not like a gourmet meal.
Gotcha.
Yeah.
And I'm sure there's some Maharashtrians right now ready to fight me.
Wait a minute.
Yeah. But show me, like, this is a strict Maharashtrian restaurant.
Right.
No, it's going to be, they specialize in street food.
Right.
Mm.
But they do serve it in restaurants.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And then you also have some dishes that come from different parts of the country, but South Indian or tandoori chicken.
Your sister told me she was going to fix me. I hope I'm saying it right. Some vada pav. Vada pav.
Oh, vada pav.
Vada pav.
Yeah.
Is that Maharashtrian? Is that street food?
Vada pav. I'm saying it like in American accent. Vada pav.
You're right.
Is it's like a donut,
uh-huh.
But it doesn't taste sweet.
Right.
And you put different things on it, like chickpeas and stuff like that.
Uh-huh.
Huh. And it's really street food.
She told me it was. I asked her to describe it, and she said it's like a burger, but it's not a burger. Like, right. I don't know how to explain it.
Yeah, so, it is.
But it is Maharashtrian. It's like street food. It's not like you wouldn't go to a restaurant.
But you will find it sometimes up north. You'll find it all over the place.
Yeah. In it's a restaurant or just on the
street? In certain restaurants.
Okay.
So you would not go to an Iranian. When I say Iranian restaurant, don't think of it like Iran.
Uh-huh.
Okay, these are just food places.
Right.
You won't ask for vada pav. They won't have it there.
Would they have it at Royal India here in Raleigh or here in North Carolina?
They do have it here.
They do?
They do have it here because here you got to have a mixture of everything. But they don't have any South Indian food at that restaurant.
Last thing I want to ask you, because I know when I went with you to Israel, and Ryan, I know you can attest to this too, when you went to Greece, and you eat the food there, then you come home and you're like, man, I want some Mediterranean food.
Yeah.
It ain't the same.
Absolutely
not. It's not the same.
When you go to Royal India, are you like, man, I'm glad to have some Indian food, but it's not the same?
It comes the closest, I would say,
really?
to eating.
Okay.
But again, my sister has been here and she brought some, what do you call masala?
Mm-hmm.
Masala is like the spices put together in this paste. It doesn't have to be refrigerated. It's just this thing. And she's used it to cook Indian food here, and it's a whole different taste.
Yeah.
Gotcha.
Because that spice mixture masala was actually put together in India.
Wow.
You have to buy it in special places. And then what people do is now, growing up, you would make that paste at home.
Mm-hmm.
I remember my grandmother, my mom, you know, having all these spices and all this stuff, and they would ground them and mix them and, you know, roll them together and make this mixture and then put it in the dish and then cook it. But people are too lazy now to do that. So they go to these restaurants or these stores and they buy a ready-made masala.
Hmm.
Now, here's the funny thing. I'll move on after that because the show is not about food.
And I'm starting to get kind of hungry, too.
So when British soldiers would leave India, and I'm talking about from the 1700s into the 1947.
Long time.
Yeah. So that's like 200 years.
Mm-hmm.
The first Indian restaurant in England was in 1790s.
Wow.
Wow.
Yeah. Indian restaurant in London was in 1790s.
Wow.
That's crazy.
Still there?
Wow.
No, it closed, but it reopened somewhere else.
Okay.
Because just that location was too old and you know, they had to redo the building. But when British soldiers would leave to go home for a furlough or for whatever, this is over the 1700s into the 1800s, into the 1900s up to 1947. They decided to package the same thing, okay, to take that taste with them so they can cook it back in England. By the way, in England, it's a treat to go eat Indian food.
Really?
Wow. Nobody says, let's go eat British food.
No, not they got like stale beans.
I'm like, I wanted to eat British food. I ate it twice. And it was like, God.
No, is it just like tasteless mush?
No, it was not tasteless mush. It was just not done right. Like one night we had, I think we had fish.
Oh.
And it was just not good.
Oh, I bet.
Not cooked well.
Did they have beans for breakfast?
Yeah, they had beans.
Ugh.
And it was not done well.
That's gross.
So we actually ended up eating Indian food. I'm like, well, because everybody's like, oh, there's a great Indian restaurant over here, there. Pizza. I ate pizza a couple nights.
Yeah.
So the food that they're known for, even that they don't do well.
Yeah.
Well,
I think even British people would tell you their food's nothing to write home about. Well, there's videos of like British school children eating American food, and they're like, I want this.
This is great.
Yeah.
So the British soldiers would take this masala packets with them.
Uh-huh.
And that's where the whole idea of masala came.
Wow.
Indians didn't make masala. They just cooked right there.
Wow.
To have this paste is a British thing.
There you go.
And I would imagine that's probably not the same thing as the bottled tikka masala stuff I have on
it
my...
It comes close.
Okay.
It comes close.
Wow. Well, asked and answered. There you go.
Very cool. Well, the verse of the day today is coming to us from Nehemiah chapter 9, verse 17.
Shout out to the book of Nehemiah.
Shout out Nehemiah. They refused to obey, and they were not mindful of your wonders that you did among them, but they hardened their necks. And in their rebellion, they appointed a leader to return to their bondage. But you are God, ready to pardon, gracious and merciful, slow to anger, abundant in kindness, and did not forsake them.
Mm. Mm. Reminds me of when Jesus was talking to the Pharisees, and you just keep asking me for stuff. You keep asking me for signs and wonders.
Stiff-necked people.
Right, and he's like, but you're just hardened. The more you ask and the more I show you, the more hardened your hearts get.
That's right.
That's crazy.
That's human nature, isn't
it? Yeah, it is. It really is. Well, Dr. Shah, we were talking about, speaking of stiff-necked people, this is this is something that has become something of a favorite on the show, the worship fails.
Oh.
We found a worship fail today. We're just going to show you one, but it's such a worship fail, and it's not a worship fail in the sense of it's cringy or it's actually, production-wise, it's excellent. Mixing-wise, it's excellent. Worship, I just want to show it to you. I want you to know. This is on a Sunday morning in a church, in a church that preaches Jesus Christ. And so this is worship.
An evangelical church.
An evangelical church. Yes, I should say that. This is in an evangelical church on a Sunday morning, on Super Bowl Sunday morning. And this is the time of worship. So to keep that in mind, because this is worship, right? We're expressing our gratitude and our response to Christ. And so this is it. Cowboy hat in church, that's fine.
Hold on.
Is that a...
Now, I don't know if this is a new worship song, but I
got friends in
like
low
I've
places.
Yeah, I've heard this song before somewhere.
Yeah.
Let me just... Siri.
They got lyrics on the screen.
Yeah. Siri, play this song. What is this song? Okay.
Huh?
Oh, wow.
Wow, didn't even... Siri's saying that this is a Tim McGraw song. It's not a worship song. Yeah, they got lyrics. I mean, this is crowd participation encouraged. This is a big church.
Oh, boy.
Where the whiskey drowns and the beer chases my blues away.
Now, this is in a church, I should say. This is in an evangelical church. On a Sunday morning. This is Sunday morning worship.
Wow. So they played this Sunday morning?
This is Sunday morning worship. To my knowledge, David, our engineer, actually showed this to us. And when I hear worship fails, I'm thinking, man, oh, someone's
horrible
out,
music.
Off pitch.
Yeah,
the live stream mix
your
is good.
I mean, they sound
apart.
Great, except they're singing a drinking song.
Oh, yeah. 100% drinking song in the house of God. And that's what I wanted to point it out. That's why it's such a worship fail, because if this is a time of worship, a response to what Christ is doing, what are we doing?
What are we
singing
doing?
Not only just secular songs like Tim McGraw, what are we doing singing a drinking song? What is that?
Yeah, I don't get it. I don't understand.
There's one more where they sing club songs. They sing club anthems. So believe it or not, they actually sing. If you skip to 45, they actually have, this is Usher's Yeah. Now this
I
is
know, I don't know this song.
If you hear it, you'll probably recognize it. It's about picking up women in a bar.
Oh really?
Or
put
in
your glow sticks up high in the air.
Yeah, to take them home. Is this Thunderstruck?
That's what it sounds
AC/DC?
Like.
AC/DC.
Yeah.
Yeah. I think Yeah is right. There it is. She was all up on
she
me
was
screaming.
All up on me
yeah,
screaming.
Yeah. This isn't a church. I just feel like I got to keep saying that. You're my little boo thing. Yeah, yeah. They got.
So they they played this Sunday morning?
This was
they played at church service?
This is, to my knowledge, I don't think this is like a Super Bowl pre-party. I think this is Sunday morning worship.
I feel like nauseous.
Yeah.
I guess my question would be, I mean, of course, we don't approve that.
Right, no.
What was their purpose behind it? You know, now Crossroads Church
right.
is in Ohio. The Kentucky, mm-hmm. Ohio area. Mm-hmm. Got many campuses, 31,000, 50,000 some members,
right.
whatever.
Right.
I think the fourth largest growing whatever church. And so I did some research on it mm-hmm. before we watched these videos. Brian Tome is the pastor.
Right.
Coming out of Reformed Theological Seminary. I guess this is their...
This is their website right here.
This is their...
Super Bowl of Preaching.
Yeah.
Okay. So this was their... So I guess that's the Sunday. I mean, can you hear part of the preaching? Like, what does he say?
Yeah, let's hear something.
Let's see. Is it... Can we go right there?
That's not the preaching. It's just the trailer.
All right. Okay. Go up to the top and see where his preaching is. Because 45 minutes into it, and they're still doing the music. So...
There you go.
I'm guessing he probably... Yeah, get right there.
There you go.
Had an ongoing struggle in his life, and he went to Jesus many times and asked him to take it away, and Jesus had some words for him, and these words are for you too today.
Go further out.
He says, my
I'm just not going to help you. I'm not into your thing. I'm just, God, live your life, see how you do. Does that or does this? I'm going to have to bring you down now. I'm going to have to bring you unique pain points in your life because of your relevancy, because of your pridefulness. And when we are graceful, when we have humility.
Is that a toilet bowl lid?
Huh?
That's a toilet bowl lid
on the pulpit.
God goes, I'm going to give grace to pull you up, to lift you up. So we can think of one of two things. We can
go further up.
Columbus and all this stuff, but it's what kind of city is it? It's the city of Cincinnati, which is what kind of city? An irrelevant city. It's utterly irrelevant. Mark Twain, he said, when the end of the world comes, I want to live in Cincinnati because everything in Cincinnati. No apologies for the fact that we like to have fun every once in a while around here. We think God has blessed us, all of us, with the ability to laugh. And we need to exercise that gift every once in a while. So we try to have fun every weekend to some degree or another. But this, if it's your first time here, this is very unusual. Very unusual.
Yeah, I would say so.
We would love to have you back next week. Or the week after that, we're going to be looking at Jesus, just a raw, straight down the pipe. Who is this guy who's the most important person the world has ever known as through the eyes of the God?
So I think what they're trying to do, that was sort of their meeting lost people where they are kind of thing.
Uh-huh.
I think that's what they're trying to do. You know, is it a Christ-honoring means to do that? Probably... In my definition, probably not.
I would have to agree.
Yeah. In my definition, is it a Christ-honoring means to do that?
Yeah.
I think they're taking a lot of risk in going down where it's almost like they're going down the dark hole towards hell to rescue people who are headed to hell. I think that's what they're trying to do.
Right.
Meet them there, bring them out, kind of thing happening.
Right.
But you're taking a chance there because... just know God is powerful and God works in mysterious ways, so does the devil.
Right.
Yeah.
And of course, I know God is way more powerful than the devil. They're not an equal match. It's not Jesus versus the devil thing. But if you're going to evoke and utilize the enemy's tool to grab people's attention and then bring them towards the gospel, I mean... You don't know how the enemy will also use that for a different purpose.
That's right. That's right.
So I'll go and tell you this. Those who are listening to me, I'm looking right at the camera right now. I'm not into legalism. I don't care for legalism. People accused us as a church, too, of being like, you're departing because you don't sing those old traditional hymns. So, you know, we sort of go off the script. The typical traditional, you know, these are the lines, these are the boundaries, and if you don't, then... I'm not coming to your church. So we are accused of that. But I think it's risky.
True. Mm-hmm. Very risky. And our worship goes off script in the sense that it's not bound by creative limitations.
Yeah.
We do not go off script in the sense that
We're going to sing
a drinking song.
Right.
Because at the end of the day, we believe 100%. We have an entire evangelism team. We have an evangelism ministry in our Kindle ministry. We have outreach. And so we're all about going out and reaching people where they are and meeting them where they are.
Yeah.
That doesn't mean that our time, our worship that's supposed to be devoted to God looks like that. They look different.
Yeah.
You know?
I think it's very risky to do what they did. Mm-hmm. And I'm sure they're going to be saying, yeah, it is risky. And I mean, the pastor admits right there that, yeah, this is not typical. We don't usually do this. Do come back next Sunday and you're going to see what our worship looks like.
True.
So we don't want to unfairly judge them based on this is who they are.
Mm-hmm.
But also I did some research on them and I'm not sure, maybe we need to do more research.
Right.
Their stance on several things did not seem as in my understanding of scripture, as biblically aligned.
Oh, I'm
like,
sure.
Like when it came to allowing people who are in a homosexual lifestyle to serve.
Mm-hmm.
Now, at Clearview, there is not just the staff, but also volunteers. They have to sign a covenant.
That's right.
Which says that you do not espouse that lifestyle or support it.
That's right.
You do not practice that lifestyle or support it. I don't think that's the case, what I found with a quick 10-minute research.
Yeah.
That's how they believe. I think they are trying to really go down the highways and the byways to win people.
Right.
But I think there's some compromising happening
there. I would say so as well.
Absolutely. I was trying to think, like, you know, what is the motivation here? What is the reasoning behind it? And Jesus met people where they were. Jesus went out and interacted with people in the world. But when people interacted with Jesus, he didn't change who he was.
Yeah.
And they were changed as a result.
Right. And also when Jesus was in the temple, he gave to God what belonged to God. You know what I mean? Yeah. It wasn't like he was like, all right, let's bring all the prostitutes and the tax collectors and put them right here in the middle of the temple and we're just going to sing drinking songs and we're going to hang out and have fun. And, you know, he knew that there was separation. He would go out to meet them where they were, but also during God's time, he gave God what he was, God was due.
That's right.
I think that's critical.
Theologically, I would disagree with this church in some of those places. And there's some other places I saw as well when it comes to the role of men in pastoral leadership. Mm-hmm. I think I would definitely disagree with them at that point because they have women in that leadership position. And again, nothing wrong with ladies, but as a senior pastor position, that should not be the case.
That's right.
Or even one of the lead pastor positions, that should not be the case.
That's right.
Again, doesn't mean women cannot serve in ministry at other capacities. So I don't know if that church, I would align with them on that level. I appreciate them wanting to reach lost people.
Yeah.
Because I am sick and tired of we're going to do the old-fashioned way, and y'all been to our, or if not, go to hell.
Yeah.
You know, I can't, I don't understand that. So a church that wants to reach people, okay, you get some points for that. Does it need to be like that?
Mm-hmm.
I don't know. I think you really, I don't think it was a Christ-honoring means.
No, not at all. And I think you hit the nail on the head. Maybe this is something we can talk about on tomorrow's show because I think you, like you said, you can't use the enemy's weapons to bring, because didn't David do that? Didn't David go about, he stole Goliath's sword and tried to take the weapon of the enemy and go to, if you can't use the weapon of the enemy to win people to Christ.
Yeah. There are some people who will take that argument and say, well, you bring some rock and roll music in the church and that's the enemy stuff. Now what do we do at that point?
Is it the enemy's?
I don't think so.
Yeah.
So that's where we have to go, okay, we're talking about style of music versus the message in the song.
Right. The actual lyrics, the content of the song.
Yeah. The soundscape of the music you're hearing versus, like you said, what the song's actually espousing.
Yeah.
Yeah. So it is not as clear cut. And I know they can easily, and sometimes some churches like this, knowing their personality, they revel in it. They love it. The more they get attacked, it's like the more publicity for us.
Yeah, true.
And hey, you sick and tired of that dead old church over there? Come to us. We're
fun.
We're fun.
Yeah.
Yeah, we have fun.
We're different.
Yeah, we'll sing drinking songs on Sunday morning, and you can
not always
you can feel great about it. Not always, but when it matters, we will.
But even if this isn't characteristic of your worship every weekend or even most weekends, you put this forward as your face online and in front of these people who are in attendance. Your worship is honoring someone or something. Yeah. Those songs did not point people.
Well, I think you hit the nail on the head because whether or not it's like this, this is your time of worship.
Right.
So if you feel like I can sing Usher's Yeah, I can sing Tim McGraw's.
Friends
in Low Places. I can sing. They did. We didn't show it, but they did Miley Cyrus's Wrecking Ball, for goodness sake. If you can say, God, this is my worship to you, then hey, well, yeah. And you can. I can't say nothing more to you.
I'm going to tell you, I think they would answer back by saying, it's not a worship to God. We're simply using this as a net to catch people. That's what they will say.
I got you.
So at that point, you go, that net.
Yeah. Pick a different net.
Maybe pick a different net.
Yeah, that net. I think the holes in that net are a little too wide.
Yeah.
There you go.
Yeah,
I like
a little
that.
Too much.
The holes were a little too wide on that net.
Yeah, I agree. Maybe we'll talk about this tomorrow because I think there's some other things. Maybe you guys write in and let us know what you think about it because I see this sparking some real interesting conversation.
Yep. Write in and let us know, 252-582-5028. Or you can visit us online at clearviewtodayshow.com. Don't forget you can partner with us financially on that same website. Every gift that you give goes not only to building up this radio show, but countless other ministries for the gospel of Jesus. Make sure you join the conversation tomorrow. We'll see you then. We love you guys from Clearview Today.